We're going to have a pretty good evening of conversation, hopefully, and some really good presentations. My name is Brad Howard. I'm the Chief of Wildlife Management Division for the Wildlife Resource Commission. I'm going to quickly introduce a few people. Our Chief Deputy Director, Kyle Briggs, is back in the back there. We've got a panel of folks up here. Some are going to be giving presentations, and some will be answering questions later. Program. Mariah Boggess is our state deer biologist. John Henry Harrelson's right there. He's your District 4 district wildlife biologist. John Shaw is the coastal regional supervisor in operations. Captain Brandon Dean is our law enforcement captain. Sarah Vandenberg is our wildlife health biologist. I want to make sure everybody realizes that this is being streamed live on Facebook thanks to Carolina Sportsman. So the camera's back there, so remember that if you say anything, you're on the camera. Thank you guys for being there, and with that, I'm going to introduce our communications director, Fairley Model, is back there, and our policy manager, Carrie Ruhlman, is back there as well. So, and then, of course, you see the guys in uniforms, the green shirts, the gray shirts, all those folks are wildlife staff, and so if you need anything, by all means, let them know. Basically, the way tonight's going to go is we're going to do three presentations for you guys. They're not terribly long. Hopefully, they're very informative. Everybody got a card when you came in. What we found out in doing a couple of these two times is the best way to facilitate questions and answers is to write your questions on the card, and then we'll pick those cards up after the presentations, and these guys will sort them up, and we'll kind of pass them around to the right person to answer the different questions. And we can have some interaction, but try to stick to the questions. I tell everybody to get through the first one, write your questions on there, but hold on and pay attention to the next two, because hopefully if we did anything right, we'll answer some of your questions in the second and the third presentation if we don't get them in the first one. So pay attention to that. And you can mark those out if we get to them. That's basically how we want to do it. One of the things that we've recognized in meeting with folks and everything is you kind of hadn't started laying the ground of what we're going to talk about CWD. We're going to talk about what it means. We're going to talk about what's going to happen this year and next year. But I want to share just a little bit about kind of what the Wildlife Commission's deer management goals are now that we know we have chronic wasting disease in the state. We deer hunting and our deer hunting culture and traditions are really important to this state, and we want to make sure we keep them intact for the most part, while we also want to make sure we're making the best management decisions for our deer herds, and especially in order to address chronic wasting disease. Ultimately, our management goals are going to be satisfied deer hunters and deer management strategies that are adapted to the realities of CWD on the landscape and our deer herds. But in order to get to that goals, we've got some steps we've got to take. And that's a lot of what we're going to talk about tonight is what those steps are. One of the first things we need to do, and Mariah and I are going to cover this and go into a little bit more detail, but one of the things that we've got to do is figure out what the prevalence of this disease is in the different deer herds. And that basically means what percentage of the deer have these prions. That tells us a little bit about where we're at in terms of how long has it been here and how many affected deer are out there. So we need to know that, and maybe more importantly right this second, we need to determine what the distribution of the disease is. That is, like I tell people, where is it? Because it's, right now we know in this neck of the woods, there was one positive deer here in Cumberland County. It's probably not the only positive deer out there. So we need to know where this disease is at. That's where you guys are going to come in and play to help us. And then the other thing that we want to make sure long term that we do is maintain opportunities for deer hunters to have their deer tested. And that's already, we've already got that process in progress of starting to work, making it where you can get your deer tested as easy as we can make it. So we're working hard to do that. So once we figure that out, that's gonna take us 3, 4, maybe 5 years before we're comfortable knowing where it's at, where we think it is for right now, and how bad is it. And then we will probably transition into some regulatory management strategies. What does that mean? That means what will our deer regulations look like? You know, we want to probably attempt to keep a, you know, a modest deer density. We're not, you know, trying to drastically lower deer densities. We're probably going to look at shifting the buck harvest earlier. We got to get in front of yearling dispersal, because for all the times we've been out here talking about waiting to after yearling dispersal, now if we got yearlings dispersing from an area that has prions, we really don't want them going 30 miles away. So Mariah will talk about that. Probably adjust our buck harvest to harvest for a somewhat younger age structure, because as you'll hear tonight, the stuff seems to show up in older deer. And then we'll have to adjust our doe harvest to address lower productivity and some age structure issues. And Mariah and I are going to get into all that. But what's not in that CWD management goal, what's not in that strategy, is somehow claiming that we can eradicate CWD from land. It's here, y'all. So it can't be destroyed, it can't be eradicated. And we also don't really particularly want to imply that we can stop it from spreading. All we really want to do is slow it down to the best of our ability. You'll see examples of CWD across the country, and Mariah will talk about that. But the one thing I want to stress before we jump into the presentation is that there's nowhere in our response plan, there's nowhere in our long-term CWD management plans that we indicate that we want to eradicate deer populations. That's not the goal. You know, what we want to do is adjust our management strategies to adjust to the realization of this disease. Because the truth be told, it can't be done. Like I said, the prions are here, they're not going to go anywhere. Can't destroy them, can't eradicate them. And in reality, trying to eradicate the deer herds doesn't really work anyway. We do have the benefit of looking back over 29 other states, and that's not really a viable option to even try. So I just want, you know, to kind of start the night off with everybody understanding that those are not things that are in our CWD response plan, nor are they in our long-term management strategies as we're thinking about them now. So if you will write your questions down as we go, I'm going to turn it over to Mariah and let her jump in and talk a little bit about disease, and then Chris is going to talk about regulations, and then John Henry is going to talk about some local things we've already got going and put into place. So. All right.
Okay, so we're going to talk kind of high level about CWD and why it's so important. You know, there's a lot of different diseases or injuries that can cause deer to be unhealthy. We don't have forums where this many people show up to talk about it. CWD is a whole different beast, and I'm going to kind of put that into perspective today and really detail some of the challenges around managing CWD. This map shows the current known distribution of CWD positive deer across the country. The gray shaded counties are where it's been found in wild deer. Why this is important and really important to our talk today, you look there in northern Colorado, southern Wyoming, that's where the disease was first observed or noticed by scientists back in the late 60s. Since then, it was found in wild deer in Colorado and Wyoming, and it slowly spread eastward since then. Now you'll see areas like right there in southern Wisconsin, southwest Wisconsin, it's kind of hard to even see the epicenter anymore because it's spread so far across that state. Southern Michigan, southwestern Tennessee, where there's these groups of counties that are removed from the big connected web of CWD. And that's where the disease has been moved by people, you know, accidentally over time and been introduced to new herds. And you know, now it would seem we find ourselves in the same situation here in North Carolina, where we have groups of positive counties that are not connected to the other large area where we know the disease already exists. This is why we've been testing for CWD for so many years, because we anticipated likely eventually it would come and we wanted to be ready. We couldn't be sure that it wouldn't get moved here and jump from another state. So this is the current known distribution now, and I say known distribution, which is an important qualifier. The disease can be out there in the deer herd without detecting it, at least in the first few years of it being in the deer herd, because there's so few infected individuals. And the prevalence, the percentage of infected deer in the herd, just grows over time. Now, to really get into the weeds about CWD, I want to first qualify how it's different from hemorrhagic disease. probably heard all kinds of discussions around EHD. That's just an acronym for epizootic hemorrhagic disease and blue tongue. Both of those we can collectively just refer to as hemorrhagic disease. This is the classic syndrome where we see deer dying in late summer. Usually happens over a couple of weeks, over a month or two. And a lot of times it'll be in small pockets in a county or two, or sometimes it's a little bit more widely spread. Last year, all across the state, we had some isolated reports of hemorrhagic disease. We test those deer. After they die, we'll send in tissues to the lab and we can narrow down whether it's EHD or blue tongue. But either way, it falls under hemorrhagic disease. Now, hemorrhagic disease, it does kill a lot of deer. Hemorrhagic disease has been here for hundreds of years. As long as there are really records around white-tailed deer, we know hemorrhagic disease has been in the Southeast. It's only recently started to move up into the upper Midwest, but it's always been here in the Southeast, which is important because Southeastern deer populations have had hundreds of generations to adapt to this disease, and they do pretty well with EHD. Now, while deer do die during these hemorrhagic disease outbreaks, they bounce back pretty quickly. And that's because these outbreaks are cyclical. So we'll have deer die during a hemorrhagic disease year. There'll be a few years where there's very few deer dying from hemorrhagic disease before there'll ever be another outbreak. And because of that, it allows the deer herd to rebound. And you know, we'll get up to the numbers it was prior to the hemorrhagic disease outbreak. And it might be some time before it happens again. And the other aspect of this is that with hemorrhagic disease, deer only die in late summer during a few weeks or a month or two. So now I'm going to talk about all the differences with CWD. With CWD, deer die year-round just because it's not a seasonal disease. If a deer is infected, they can die any month in the year. So it's, deer aren't just dying during 1 month or two in late summer. It's year-round. It's also not cyclical in any matter or fashion. Once it's in a deer herd, it just increases in prevalence, which means just more and more deer in that herd become infected with the disease. And we'll talk in a minute how that is. But over time, this just creates more of a drain on the deer population as more and more infected individuals are out there and more are out there spreading the disease. Also, one big difference. With hemorrhagic disease, some deer survive. With hemorrhagic disease, these deer that survive have immunity. And oftentimes, those deer will hold immunity for a year or two. And they can even pass that on to their offspring for a brief amount of time. This is another way that our deer are adapted to hemorrhagic disease and why they rebound so quickly. Because when you have a bad hemorrhagic disease year, the deer that are left out there on your property, they're pretty much immune to the disease for a year or two, which again allows them to their population to bounce back. As of right now, there's not a white-tailed deer out there known to science that is resistant to CWD. All of them are susceptible to the disease, and when they get it, they eventually will die. Now, this takes some time. It takes about a year and a half to 2 years before the deer shows symptoms and dies, but it will eventually die from the disease. And so that's one of the really big major points and differences between CWD and hemorrhagic disease. And the one other one, before we move on, I want to touch on is the infectious agent. With CWD, the disease is caused by a prion. Now, a prion is nothing but protein. So all of our bodies, any animal's bodies, even plants, body, you know, plants, cells, they're all made up of proteins. These are the building blocks of cells. This is the building structure of life. Proteins are normal. There's a special type of protein known as a prion. It's just a special type. It's a specific kind of protein. That prion protein can become misfolded. And when it does, it causes a prion disease. In this case with deer, that's CWD. A couple interesting aspects about a prion disease like this. Because it's just misfolded protein, it's a misfolded prion protein, it cannot be killed. And by definition, the body can't break it down. We have body enzymes that naturally break down proteins. This one is resistant to all of that, which causes it to build up in the deer's body over time. And that's what leads to the development of holes in the brain. You can kind of see that here on the slide. Holes in the brain on the right, normal brain on the left. You can also see the picture of, you know, the microscopic level, what the prion misfolded protein would look like. So this is the really big difference between this and hemorrhagic disease. Hemorrhagic disease is caused by a virus, which is living bacteria that can, or living material that can, of course, infect the deer, but also dies in the environment. Prions don't die because they're not alive, which means they can persist in the environment for decades. There's actually no known expiration date, at least known to science, for a prion. So if it's available to a deer now or 100 years, that deer intakes it, it will cause CWD. So what does CWD look like in a deer? Most of the time it looks just like this. There's nothing special about that deer. It's a healthy looking deer. CWD is a very slowly progressing disease, both across the landscape and within a deer. After being infected with CWD prions, it's about 16 to 24 months before that animal starts to exhibit clinical signs of the disease. And this is what you see in magazines talking about CWD. There's a photo like this on the right, a really skinny deer standing there drooling, just a bag of bones. And that is what a CWD infected deer looks like right before it dies. But there's also the 16 to 24 months leading up to it when it's alive, it's out there on the landscape spreading prions and putting those out into the environment. When a deer contracts CWD prions, they first build up in the retropharyngeal lymph nodes, which are basically, they would be like right under your tongue at the base of your head. These are the lymph nodes that we test in deer because these are the first ones where prions build up and we can actually detect them. So there's a reason we have to test, you know, dead deer, and there's a reason that we want deer heads. It's because that's the best place to test for it. From the retropharyngeal lymph nodes, it spreads throughout the lymphatic system. This is all kind of happening at the same time, but following the lymphatic system is spreading to the central nervous system. This is where it really starts to build up in the brainstem and in the brain of the deer. And of course, that's what eventually leads to clinical signs. But even in later stages of the disease, prions spread throughout the body. They're in the muscle tissue, so the meat. They're in the GI tract. They're in all different body tissues. But during this time, that deer that's out there walking around infected is also causing prions through saliva, through feces, and through urine. Those are the three main ways during that 16 to 24 months. When the deer looks perfectly normal to us, it can be spreading this disease around. And so you just think about how many times a deer defecates or urinates in a day, or again, feeds and might deposit saliva somewhere. And again, those prions, once they're there, they're not going away. That's why, as we talk about this disease, we're talking about it from a permanent perspective. As unfortunate as that is, once the prions are there and there's an infected deer out there, you know, you can't put the cat back in the bag. They're out there and there's no getting rid of them because you can't kill them. And the longer, you know, it's out there and the more infected deer that live in a county over time, the more and more prions there will be. And in states that have had CWD for many years, very early, the prevalence, the percentage of the deer infected is very low. You know, they might find it at 1% or lower. And for a few years, it stays pretty low and then it starts to climb. And it takes time to start gaining momentum. And what we're really talking about is decades before it hits a really high prevalence, we start seeing negative effects in the deer population. That's from a low prevalence to a high prevalence, that it takes decades. This also relates to that first map that I shared. We know CWD has been out west for a while, and of course it's popping up closer and closer to us. The disease moves really slow on the relatively slow on the landscape in a deer population. And primarily where it makes jumps is through deer dispersal, young bucks dispersing. And Brad talked about this a little bit in relation to regulations and how we approach that. Yearling bucks that might contract the disease within their first year and leave their home range. So some percentage, over 50% of young bucks will leave their fawn range when they're about a year old to 18 months old. So right before their hunting season with their first antlers, they'll leave their home range and travel some distance away, 5 miles. This is about the average here in the Southeast, but they can travel 30, 40, 50 miles or more. That's more the rarity. But during these 5 mile jumps, that's where the disease is making hops. That's where it's really making some distance. And then once it's introduced to a local deer population, doe groups, it just kind of spreads and moves within. And so, you know, over time, the disease spreads very slowly out of these areas, but it's important to stay on top of the surveillance outside of those areas because it can jump through human movement. So why does it matter? Why is CWD so important to deer management? As I talked about, it's a very permanent disease. What we know from these other states is that prevalence will increase, and it's not a question of if, it's just how fast. Prevalence, percentage of infected animals just always climbs. Regardless of what states have taken action-wise, even drastic actions, shooting deer and whatnot, the prevalence still climbs. So we've learned a lot. We're the 30th state to have found the disease, so we've been able to learn from those mistakes. We're also been able to learn what we can anticipate to happen. On average, deer lifespans will be shortened. This will lead to population changes. If we look at the deer herd in North Carolina, through all of our deer statistics that we gather every year, we can say there's about 50% fawn recruitment rate. This is an average across the state. In other words, for every one doe out there, there's about a 50% chance she'll successfully rear a fawn into hunting season. This is what we term recruitment. They're in the fall hunting population. They've been recruited. In other words, it takes about 2 years for one doe out there walking around, to successfully replace herself. That's the point at which she could be killed, and there's another deer or fawn to replace her, and the population doesn't decline. If we look at the age structure, this is actually part of the state, which is pretty cool, from across our state. This is the age structure of our harvest, and I will put bucks and does on there. Blue bars are buck age structure, and red are does. You'll see that we have a lot of older age class does, and 45% of our harvest is determined to be 3.5 years old or older in the doe segment of our herd. Now just imagine in a CWD world, if we lose that portion of the population, and eventually over time, when the prevalence continues increasing, it gets high enough, we'll start to whittle away at that. We lose that 45%. Well, that's 45% of the does out of the deer woods. Also think about those are the does that are the best reproducers. They're older females. They're at least a few years in. They've kind of learned the ropes. They can produce fawns. Those are the deer that are out across all of our counties and successfully recruiting fawns every year. And so in a CWD endemic area where it's been for some time and the prevalence has increased to a high level, eventually you'll hit a point where does are dying too quickly to successfully reproduce. So in other words, they're not getting two full reproduction cycles out. You know, they're not getting to 2 or 3 years old to successfully reproduce. They're dying earlier because of CWD. That's what will really start to drive that population down and why we say, you know, in a matter of time, decades down the road, we do expect there to be population declines. But we don't expect it to happen this year or next year. This isn't something that's gonna happen overnight. It's not like we're gonna have deer dying everywhere tomorrow because of CWD. This is very different than hemorrhagic disease. But it is a disease that we know from watching other states that it will just continue to march on and it will get worse. So, just touching on CWD in North Carolina, we've been surveilling for the disease since 1999. We've been actively looking for it, and we first found it last March up in Yakin County. We implemented some regulations, had some surveillance areas designated there, and tested a whole bunch of deer. We tested a bunch of deer in the surveillance areas as well as statewide, which is what ended up turning up the one in Cumberland County. And we had 9 additional positives last year. So we have, we're up to 10 confirmed positives with locations across the state. I'm going to pop up this map that just kind of shows where they are geographically. You can see where we are down here, we're quite a ways from the northwestern corner there. The disease doesn't jump that quickly. You know, I spent a little time there talking about dispersal and how that kind of happens. The disease, you know, it's not so fast moving that we have an outbreak 1 year and an outbreak, you know, this far away somewhere else the next year. We've more than likely uncovered, you know, another infected area. We've tested a whole bunch of deer in between both of those, all of those infected counties. We've tested thousands of deer through Piedmont and haven't found an infected deer there. So, you know, the disease is we know it's in the Northwest, we know it's in the Southeast. That's pretty much all we can say about the Southeast right now is we know we have at least one, there's likely more. And so that's where we're at. Just a little bit of information on the deer that brought us all here tonight. It was harvested during rifle season of last year. It was tested by one of our Servant Health cooperators, actually a taxidermist, but we have taxidermists and processors in this program statewide where you can take your deer, they test it, and they perform their services they normally perform there. It's a very successful program. John Henry will be speaking about it here in a little bit and all the additional locations that will be coming this year in the surveillance area. But one of our taxidermists tested this deer. There's actually some photos of the deer there, both prior to and shortly after the harvest. And of course, find the disease in a new area of the state. We do a lot of research and investigation just to make sure that that deer did indeed live and die in Cumberland County. The last thing we want to do is, you know, find a deer that was brought in illegally or something and it got traced to here. We did that investigation. We have photos from the kill site, which is sure enough Cumberland County, and even matched the deer with DNA to confirm that deer was indeed the positive deer that died there. We can't say where that deer came from. I mean, he could have dispersed from a couple miles away. You know, this was just on the front end of the rut. He might have been a mile or two out of his home range. But he sure enough lived and died right there in Cumberland County, and we know that. So this is a big occasion. It's our first detection in the coastal plain, and because of that, we'll have all new surveillance areas. So what can be done? This is my last slide, and we'll turn it over. The major points, what we can do as hunters and wildlife managers, number one, to do anything to address this disease, we really have to know where it is. You got to know where, you know, your enemy is, what you're up against, before you can really effectively do anything. So first off, a lot of testing. We've done this in the northwestern corner last year. We'll be doing it there again this year, as well as down here. Testing as many deer as we possibly can. The second point there, and this is probably the biggest for everyone out there, for all of us hunters, is that don't give this disease a ride. Yeah, I showed that map at the beginning. There's plenty of examples across the country where the disease has gotten moved. You know, you never can trace it back to one, you know, this person did this or that, but we do know that the disease does get moved in live deer and in dead deer. If there's a deer body getting moved and it's infected, it could introduce the disease elsewhere. So fawns getting moved predominantly or dead deer post-harvest getting moved and then, you know, butchered and disposed of out on the landscape could be problematic. Especially, again, I mentioned how the prions build up in the central nervous system, that's the spinal cord. It always gets thrown out after butchering a deer. If that's out there in the landscape, of course, that could create a new hotspot. So the third point here, slowing transmission rates, and this just addresses deer-to-deer interactions and minimizing our effect on that. We know that deer interact throughout the breeding season, throughout the whole season. Doe groups interact, bucks interact with each other, and of course during the breeding season there's some crossover there. But avoiding unnecessarily congregating deer, cramming deer into small areas, I'm speaking here specifically about feed outside of hunting season, where different groups of deer that would not normally interact might interact over a feed site, a mineral site, and or even if two doe groups that wouldn't normally interact aren't there at the same time, they can also interact indirectly by depositing prions if one's infected and another one visiting later on, and therefore causing additional transmission. And that's the transmission rate point on the end. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Chris and he's going to talk about regulations.
Sound? Folks back here?
Okay.
Very good. Let's see. Cue up a few more slides. Okay. Brad introduced me a little bit earlier. My name is Chris Craig. I work with a lot of our game species management. So my job for the next 15 or 20 minutes here is to explain the new rules that you're going to see when you pick up your copy of the Regulations Digest this year. It's important stuff, but my job is not just to tell you what the rules are, but try to connect it to what Mariah is telling us about the disease itself, and then really connect it to what Brad's telling us about where is the agency trying to get our deer hunting community and our deer herd several years in the future. Why are we doing all this stuff right now? That's where we're going with this. So there's five broad areas there that we need to talk about. We need to talk about fawn rehabilitation and what that means from a regulation standpoint. We need to talk obviously we need to talk about the use of bait and food on the landscape, and there's some new rules that affect that. We need to make sure everybody's up to speed on what hunters are allowed to do in terms of deer urine and other type of attractants like that. We'll touch on that. We're going to get down into the weeds now about CWD testing and what we mean when we say testing or sampling and what's mandatory for hunters to do. And then finally, we're going to come back to the point that Mariah mentioned to us just a minute ago. We're going to talk about carcass transportation and why that's so important that we do the best we can with that. All right, so these rules are going to be, that we're talking about, are going to be in effect in our surveillance areas. So we had first detection CWD established our surveillance area number one in the northwestern part of the state last year. A lot closer to home is surveillance area two, right down here in the southeastern part of the state. So I'm not going to spend a whole lot of time here tonight talking about surveillance area one. I know we've probably got some folks streaming in on Facebook that are seeing this, but the rules are very similar between the northwest and the southeast. So the infected counties that we know of up there are Wilkes, Yadkin, Surrey, and Stokes. That's where those nine positive samples have come from. And then some border counties there that are secondary areas. So closer to home, Cumberland County. That is the county that we know is infected. And then we have five counties that are surrounding that. They're kind of on that list. If they're pretty close, it might be there as well. And that's sort of where these regulations are designed. So that's the area that these rules are in effect. We've had a network of folks for many, many years that have poured their heart and soul into rehabilitating orphan fawns in the summertime. One of the unfortunate realities of CWD is that's not a risk-free activity anymore. So the commission has put rules into place to prohibit the rehabilitation of fawns inside of those surveillance areas. And that's coming back to the tagline that Mariah had earlier about don't give it a ride. We really would hate to move CWD to a new part of the state simply by moving it alive here. Okay, so rules about baiting and feeding. So the rule that's in place now would say that within the surveillance areas, that's primary and secondary surveillance areas, what the rule says is that the placement of food or food products or bait outside of the hunting season is prohibited. The placement of minerals or salt licks is prohibited the entire year. So there would be a couple of exceptions to that rule as far as bait and food goes. So your backyard bird feeder would be exempted from that. Municipalities that would be enrolled in the urban archery season, hunters in those areas in January and February would be exempted from that. And then if there are other activities that have gone through the commission's permitting process, those could potentially be exempted from that as well. A great example of that is the program that USDA Wildlife Services has to trap and eradicate wild pigs in some places. They actually go through a permitting process with the commission to do that. They would still be allowed to do that as well. So the way that works basically is hunters can use bait throughout the deer hunting season. So corn, apples, all those things that folks have used in the past. And that's important for a couple reasons. Number one, surveillance and testing a lot of deer is a very important part of figuring out where we are with CWD right now. So it's important. It's an important piece of that. And it's also an important piece of maintaining hunter interest, maintaining harvest rates where they currently are, not letting those just fall off. And all that works together to slow the transmission rate. You know, prohibiting that bait and food outside the hunting season and those mineral licks and stuff, that avoids the situation of having deer unnecessarily concentrated. Okay. So switching gears a little bit. In a similar fashion, there are some rules that you need to be aware of in relation to using deer urine and attractants and those type of things. So, the bullet, and this is a little bit of a long slide here, so let's walk through it kind of slowly. So the bullet at the top basically states the law as it is right now. So in North Carolina, hunters may not use any substance that is an excretion from a deer, a member of the deer family. So that would be feces, urine, blood, gland oil, other bodily fluids, except for the things that are listed there at the bottom of the list. So basically, you can't use any of that stuff except for what's on the bottom of the list. So let's step through those ones on the bottom of the list to make sure we're on the right page. So if you're using a product that's a synthetic product, you're good to go, green light. If you're using a product that is a natural deer urine or other substance that's collected from a valid licensed deer farm here in North Carolina, you're good to go. Green light on that. If you're using a product that's labeled, you buy it in the store, and it's got the label on there that product is part of the Responsible Hunting Scent Association's Deer Protection Program, you're good to go on that one as well. If you use those products. Now, the last one on the list, there's a little bit of a twist for surveillance here. So top of that, everything I've said so far, that applies to the entire state of North Carolina. The one that's a little different inside the surveillance areas would be if a hunter legally harvests a deer and they want to collect the fluid from that deer, urine, sometimes folks use the hot glands and those kind of things. Inside the surveillance area, that would now be prohibited. You know, what Mariah keyed in on earlier, that's is really important thing. You know, those prions that are the infectious agent, they can be in lots of places in a deer's body, and we don't want those to get moved around to different parts of the state. All right. I'm glad we've got enough cards, because I know I'm hitting a lot of information, so please, but we're going to have plenty of time for questions to follow up later. CWD testing. You're going to hear that term said a lot, or sometimes we might say sample. What are we talking about? Well, we're talking about, from the hunter's perspective, we're talking about an individual deer and how we determine whether or not that deer has been infected with CWD. And really, we're talking about deer that are not in the clinical stage. It's a deer that essentially looks healthy. We need to test that animal to see if it's in those early stages of CWD. And if you're hunting down in this part of the world in any of those six counties, you need to be aware that there's a two-week period that the new rules say it's mandatory for a hunter to submit within 2 weeks of the harvest of that animal, and then to submit a sample to the commission for CWD testing. We'll talk about how you do that in a minute. There's a bunch of different ways you can do it. But for right now, just make sure you keep on that. So it's a 2 week period. That's the week of Thanksgiving and the week before that week. So November 11th through 26th, 2023. 2 week period for these counties down in this part of the world. That'll be in your regulations digest, be on the flyer. I see a lot of people writing, so I'm gonna leave that up there for just a second. So November 11th through 26th, that's the date. Now, our sampling goal, we touched on earlier, we did find one positive animal here last year, and that was out of a sample that we collected of 50 deer in Cumberland County. So did we just kind of hit the odds and find the one positive? Well, no, we need to look at lots and lots more deer to understand, are we talking about one out of 50? Everywhere, we're talking about one out of 100, one out of 1,000. So our sampling goal for this coming year for the six counties collectively is about 2,000 deer that we would like to test. That will really give us a much, much better picture of what's going on. So we would like to get samples throughout the entire season, but this two-week period is a very busy time. It's when the commission staff, we can dedicate our resources, we can do it the most cost-effective way to get most of the way to that 2,000 deer. So that's why it's only mandatory that two-week period, not the entire season. Okay, so if you were one of those folks that's maybe focused on the northwestern surveillance area, the dates are a little bit different. It's still a two-week period, but it's the week of Thanksgiving and the week after Thanksgiving. Those are the two busiest weeks up there. So if you're hunting in the northwest, it's November 18th through December 3rd. Outside of that two-week period and outside of the surveillance areas, any CWD testing that hunters might want or that they're participating with is entirely voluntary but strongly encouraged. The commission is set up to receive those samples and we'd love to get them, but it's not mandatory outside of those areas at those times of year. And that's really just coming back to what Mariah was telling us about knowing where it is. I mean, that's really step one for figuring out how we get where we need to be. So, talk a little bit more detail here about what the test is. So it is a laboratory test. It's not something that a biologist or anybody else can do right there in the field with the deer. It requires collecting those retroparenchymal lymph nodes. Right under the jaw, retroparenchymal just means behind the windpipe. That's all it means. There's two of them. They're about size, and they actually kind of look like an oyster. That's what it looks like. It's not something that a hunter would normally keep. It'd be discarded as part of the processing, butchering process. All the trophy parts, all the edible parts, all the hide, everything else that deer can stay with the hunter, all the commission needs for the test is those two retroparenchymal lymph nodes. They're pretty easy to get once you know what you're looking for. and it, you don't have to find the lymph nodes. What you need to do is there's a couple different options that we can go through. We will have some staff to check stations. John Henry's going to talk about details of where those will be in the area down here. If that's an option, you can bring your deer by. The staff can collect those samples. You can be done right there with it. We're going to have a whole bunch of these drop-off freezer stations. I think we're going to probably have 25 or something across the six county area. So you just go by, you take the head, a couple inches of neck, put it in, you can remove the antlers first if you want to, put it in a bag, fill a little card, it's got your authorization number and stuff, put it in the freezer, you have complied with the rule at that point, as long as you do that within 2 weeks of harvest. You don't have to do that the day you kill the deer. Now, calling the number in, getting your authorization number, reporting it like you have for years and years and years, yeah, there's a time clock real quick ticking on that. But maybe you're hunting on Saturday, you take your deer, go ahead and collect the head, put it in a bag, you're going by the freezer on Tuesday or Wednesday later that week, you can drop it in then. It's perfectly fine. You don't have to do it the day that you killed the animal. You got 2 weeks to do it. So yeah, you can use the freezers, you can use the staff check station. If you're using a deer processor, that's one of our cooperating folks that we've trained up on how to get stuff, that's a great option. And there's a whole bunch of taxidermists that are doing it as well. So you've got a bunch of different options for how to get the sample to the commission. We do want to have a quick turnaround time as possible. We'd love it to be same day or just a couple days, but you're out, you're sending that thing off. It takes about 4 weeks to get the test result back before we get the result back for that deer. We do provide it to the hunter as quick as possible. If we've got a valid email address for you in the system, you'll get notification that your test result is back. That's one of the things we hope to improve on is the speed of that test. But right now, it is what it is. It's a 4 to 6 week turnaround. Okay, so getting close here to the end of my part. Let's talk about carcass transportation a little bit. You know, moving a whole deer carcass or the high risk parts potentially could infect another part of the state. That's something we really want to avoid. So when we talk about the primary surveillance areas, a whole carcass deer or those high risk parts, if they originate in Cumberland County, they got to stay in Cumberland County. That's the short way to say it. So you can't take a whole carcass animal and drive it outside of Cumberland County or outside the surveillance area part. So you gotta keep those in Cumberland County. The things that you could take out would be deboned meat, caked out hide, cleaned antlers, cleaned skulls, finished taxidermy products, clean jaw bones, clean teeth, all that kind of stuff that was permissible. That's the same rule that's actually been in the regulations for 10 or 12 years now for out-of-state hunters that are coming back into North Carolina from other states. That's the same list of exceptions. Slightly different when we talk about the secondary counties. So down in here, we're talking about those five blue counties that surround Cumberland County. So those high-risk materials can come in to Cumberland, or they can stay within the blue, but we can't take them out into the green counties. So things can come in, can't go out, is the way to think about it. So if you were hunting in Bladen County and you killed a deer and you wanted to drive it over into Sampson County because that's where you live, you want to work that, perfectly fine to go from Bladen to Sampson. If you wanted to go from Bladen County back into Cumberland County, you're going in, it's perfectly fine. If you wanted to drive from Bladen through Cumberland County into Harnett County, because that's where you live, that's perfectly fine. You could drive through that primary zone. If you wanted to take your deer and drive from Bladen, go to your home in Wake County, make sure you stop first and see Captain Dean up there. He's going to have a conversation with you. When you cross that line and you're going out into those areas or outside the surveillance area, that's when you've crossed the rule, basically broken the rule at that point. If you were hunting outside the surveillance area, Columbus County, Pender County, and you wanted to drive through the surveillance area to Wake County or Chatham or something like that, it's perfectly fine. You can do that. So you can drive through the area. You know, I mean, we've got interstates and all kinds of major highways that go through our surveillance zone. So that's okay. I would just say, just keep in mind, our folks in the field, our officers in the field, you know, they're applying a complex set of rules. So make sure you got your stuff in order. Make sure you call Grand Land, you register for Crawford County, those kind of stuff, and cooperate with them and convince that you are talking with them. I say all that right? Okay. So then the question is, Chris, I don't have any of these good options. What do I do with my carcass? How can I make sure I'm not causing a problem in other places? So what kind of carcass disposal options do I have? A really good one, and a lot of people have this on maybe the hunt club property that they have or property that they own. If you've got a pit there on the property that you normally dispose of those animals and bury them, that's perfect. That's fantastic. You know, if you can keep it right there on that same property and put it underground, that's great. If you don't have that option, there's a lot of landfills. I think John Henry and John are going to talk about landfills down here in the surveillance area. A bunch of those will accept carcasses. That's a great option. If you don't have that, you can bring it to one of our check stations. We're going to have a line dumpster at the check station. You can dispose of your carcasses there in those line dumpsters. We'll make sure it gets to the landfill and gets where it needs to be. And if you just don't have any of those options, you're going to hunt a remote section of land, you don't have a way to get it out or something, you can just bone out the animal right there at the site of kill and leave it on top of the ground. You know, if you've got the permission of the landowner to do that. That's not the perfect scenario, because there are some infectious prions in that carcass, but that's a place that deer was already living and spreading that prion on that property before that. So you haven't moved it to a new area in that situation. Okay, I covered a lot of ground. I'm sure there's questions. I'm sure there's good questions in there. But we got, I think John Henry probably going to answer a bunch of them. Is that right?
Can everybody hear me? Did you guys hear me?
Yes.
Okay, good. All right, so my name is John Henry Harrelson. I want to introduce myself because I am the local contact here. All these other guys, people from WRC, most of them came from a couple hours away. I'm the guy that lives in Cumberland County who's responsible for the nine counties that make up District 4. This deer was killed 13 miles from my house. I killed a deer within about 7 miles of where this positive is. And, you know, we talk about why we do it. This is why I'm concerned about CWD. You guys all have your own individual reasons why you're concerned about it, because you're all here. Every one of you took the time to show up tonight, to come out and learn about this. But this is my reason, and I want them to continue having the opportunity to hunt. I want them to experience what deer hunting culture was for me growing up and what it is for me right now. And so my purpose and my goal as a local biologist is to try to maintain this for as long as foreseeable possible. You know, try to maintain that culture of where we get to go out and there is deer hunting in the fall, every fall. And so part of that is working, you're pretty much getting your deer tested. We've all heard it already. It's been said a couple different times tonight. What we need from you guys is cooperation on getting your deer tested, so we can figure out just where it is, and we can kind of maybe eventually go back to living life, maybe a little like before CWD. But right now, we're nowhere close to that. So one of the big things we have in place are these servant health cooperators. And we've heard about them, they're taxidermists and processors. And I'll tell you, before we found CWD, we had six of them inside their surveillance area. That's not a lot. We anticipate that we're gonna have 20 taxidermists. We've already verbally committed to having that many. We've essentially called every licensed taxidermist inside that surveillance area. And if you go to a taxidermist and you don't see his name up here or their name up here right now, you should reach out to them and say you came to this meeting and say maybe they should come and sign up for this program. Because it's beneficial for them. There's some financial incentive on their end, but it's really beneficial for us. And this list here, we're gonna have we already have a website, but this list is gonna be up on our website. There's an interactive map. You will be able to find who's closest to you to get your deer tested, if you want to get them tested, at a taxidermist or at a processor. What we saw last year in the other surveillance area is that people really like using the freezers. And so we anticipate that there's gonna be 5 to 6 freezers in every county. I can't tell you where all of them are right now. We got about 15 of them lined out, but we still got more work to do. We're in the beginning stages of this, but that essentially leave you 50 options in those six counties between the freezers, the taxidermists, the processors, and anyone else that we sign up for you to go get your deer tested, whether you want to do it in person or whether you just want to essentially do this. And so Chris kind of went over it already, but in each of those freezers, there's a little kit already set up. We already got trash bags, we got Sharpies, we got tags for you to put on the deer. We just need your name, your contact information, your phone number, and your harvest ID number. And that information will be enough for us to link that deer to you, for us to get you those results, and for us to help track where CWD is right now. So if you don't want to take it to a taxidermist, you don't want to take it to a processor, and you live in Cumberland County, you want to come see us, we're going to be set up at the Peckman Center all fall. So if you don't know where the Peckman Center is, there's the address. At the Peckman Center, if you guys have ever been to the Peckman Center, we're going to be down here in this lower building right there. So this is a nice big building up on top of the hill that you see. We're going to be down here in the shop. We're going to have tents set up. It's going to be very visible that we're there. While we're there, we're going to be staffed during the mandatory check. It's also going to be staffed throughout other parts of the season, but during that 2-week period, there will be guaranteed somebody there. We will have a dumpster for carcass disposal. We will have an incinerator to help with carcass disposal. We will have a skin rack. If you want to come and you don't have access to a skin rack, you can come. We'll help you figure out how to skin your deer. In fact, part of what we're looking at is holding in-person training there to help people learn how to skin their deer. You guys would be surprised at how many folks don't know how to quarter out a deer, don't know how to debone a deer. I'd be glad to show you if I'm there. We're going to have training set up in coordination with the Peckman Center to do that. We're also working with potential a donation site there for Hunters for the Hungry to give another option that if you don't want to consume that meat, once it gets tested and it's deemed CWD negative, then we can donate that meat to be used in the community. So on top of the Peckman Center, if you guys hunt at Fort Bragg is going to have its own individual check station. It's going to be, if you already kill a deer on Fort Bragg, you know you're supposed to take it and get it checked already. Well, now when you go and take and get it checked, hopefully there's going to be somebody standing there to check that deer for CWD for you. And if not, there's going to be a freezer on site for you to be able to donate, well, not donate, but for you to give your sample if you want to go test it outside of that mandatory testing. So, in addition, you know, how do you find your results once you get your deer tested? So you've done all this stuff, you took it to somebody, you get the email. So we're gonna come out of this real quick, and we're actually gonna go to our website here. And so this is, we can go all the way back. So if you type into ncwildlife.org, this is our website here. And so we actually got a new updated website recently. And you see right here, that look right there, that's us. How about that? This is where you want to click on, no CWD. So pretty self-explanatory. And there's three options here, three big buttons here. There's also a lot of other data there. You can see how many deer we tested. You see we're at 51 in Cumberland County. We're actually at 52, we got a new sample yesterday. So we're still actively collecting. But if you want to get your deer tested, this is where we talk about freezers, the check station, etc. And we come down here to this nifty map. And right now that map is all bare, but you see right here, come September 1, 2023, this will all be updated with all those locations prior to hunting season. So every freezer will be on there, every taxidermist will be on there, every processor will be on there that's cooperating. On top of it, when you click on it, there'll be a little circle. You can click on that circle and it'll tell you the contact information for each person. So if it's at a sporting goods store, it'll tell you, oh, this is the name of the sporting goods store, the phone number, and these are the hours it's open. If it's behind a locked gate, it'll let you know you can't come during certain hours. A lot of hours are at volunteer fire departments, at sporting goods stores, etc. So they're open to the public 24 hours a day. So that's pretty cool. You guys should check on that. So on top of it, you want to view your test results. So this button in the future will take you to a new My Go Outdoor app, which I don't have access to yet. So it's coming in the middle of summertime. So in the future, this right here will click you and take you to a different place. Now, it takes you here where if I were to enter my WRC number and my last name, it would show you every harvest I've had. It would show you all the beer I've had tested for CWD and whether they were positive or negative. In the future, that link will take you to a slightly different page. In the center here is the regulations. It talks about the surveillance areas again, the special regulations. If you have any questions after tonight, all this is on our website. We encourage you to go to our website. I also encourage you that if you have any questions about what's going on here, to feel free to call me. My phone number is public, it's on the internet. I'd be glad to give it to you tonight. If you have questions about what's going on, if you have questions about how to get your beer tested, if you just have questions about, man, why do we even care about this, I'd be glad to talk to you and hopefully relieve some of those questions and relieve some of that worry about what we're doing for beer in North Carolina. That's it. So I think now we're going to take questions from, we have questions already lined up, correct?
So, if you guys go around, if you got questions, you got stuff on the card, take your time right on the card. I'm going to do something while I'm working on that. So while we're passing up the questions and everything, we actually had an opportunity for people that couldn't be here to submit their questions online. So I'm not going to start answering some of these unless it's set. Okay, guys? They did ask the question, is there a possibility the deer was harvested somewhere besides Cumberland County? I think Mariah fully showed you that one. You got the deer in the plot, plus the deer dead in the plot. So we know for sure where the deer came from. They did ask about test results, and Chris covered that. So, that's 4 weeks or so, we do send those. We send the test results off to Wisconsin. And you'll get a phone call if it comes back positive. We send them to the Wisconsin lab because that's the lab that can handle and process these number of deer, and they are a certified lab to test for chronic wasting disease. So that's the one we're currently using. And they give us a pretty good testing price, and they don't charge shipping. So that's a good thing. So it's as good as we can do. So, I have honey wind in Sampson, Bladen County. Will there be any restrictions on baiting outside the season? Chris covered that. And then a longer one was working with county landfills. I think we talked about that, the ability to try to work with the landfills and disposal, online mapping.
Thank you, pretty good.
If not, complete this. We told you where you can go to find your testing sites. Here's the one I'm going to touch on, and I'm going to let some other folks chime in on, because this is like one of the million. This is one of the top five questions that we get. That's on everybody's mind, and everybody wants to know. We're going to answer it the best we can. Is there any threat to humans who may consume venison of a deer who has CWD? Currently, the CDC and World Health say there is no documented evidence of chronic wasting disease crossing the species barrier and going from deer to humans. It has not been documented. They updated their recommendations a couple years ago after some tests with Macaulay's and some other primates. And they basically, the recommendation says now that they do not recommend you eating a deer that tested positive for chronic wasting disease. That was my recommendation. My recommendation is get your deer tested. If it comes back positive, don't consume any more of that meat. If it comes back not detected, then I think you're okay. And so that's my recommendation, but of course you're not required. You can, you know, if your deer comes back positive and you want to eat it, you're more than welcome to. I mean, it's not required. And there is no evidence right now to show that it's crossed the species barrier. So that's about as good. You guys got anything to add to that? Anybody? I mean, that's about as good as answers we can give to that question. I mean, my answer is, I'm gonna have my deer tested when I shoot them this year. If it comes back positive, I'm gonna throw it away. Take it to us, then we'll take it to an incinerator and get it burned up. If it comes back negative or not detected, I'm gonna eat it just like I always eat venison. Until the world changes or more information becomes involved. But I do recommend that. We're trying, and one of the things that we're trying to do is to make sure that you can get your deer tested if you want to. And the one thing we never mentioned this. For now, you know, the testing doesn't cost you anything. Just get it to the sample location, to the drop box. Nobody, you know, well, it costs you something because you bought a hunting license, all right? It's like everything else that deals with wildlife management. The sportsmen are the ones that contribute to it, but it's not, there is no cost for the test right now. We test, we pay for the state pays for the test, Wildlife Commission pays for the test. So if you want your deer tested, get it to one of these things and we'll get it tested for you and get the answer back to you as quickly as we can. We're at the mercy of batching. It takes at least a couple weeks for them just to run the test and then getting the answers back. I was pleased with how well we got the information back last year, but that's because our guys worked really hard out there processing that, getting those samples packed, getting them mailed to Wisconsin as soon as we could get them on the way, and they did really good at turning it around. So, you know, our commitment is to do it as fast as we can, but we'd like to tell everybody in the surveillance areas, you know, expect a minimum of 4 weeks. If we get it to you faster, two thumbs up, but expect 4 weeks. First question. Y'all pick it up, y'all just pass the mic to their point.
Well, there are several that asked about food plot implications of, you know, baiting and mineral licks and how food plots plays into that. There's no restrictions on food plots inside surveillance area, outside surveillance area. It does not congregate deer like a corn pile does. You know, they're spread out over a half acre, so we will continue to allow food plots inside the surveillance area.
Okay, so I've got several here. We'll start with this one. The question is about antlers. Can antlers be infected with prions? Any body part technically can, and there's actually some interesting research on antler velvet that shows it can be pretty high in prion concentration. We do allow movement of antlers out of surveillance areas, but when you start to look at the risk, we have to take into account what's going to happen with that part once it leaves. Right now, meat, clean skull plates with antlers, clean hides, those can all be moved out. But those are parts that people take and they save. Meat is consumed, antlers are hung up, they're not thrown out necessarily on the landscape like a spinal cord is or something like that. So while there can be prions in antlers, although probably at pretty low rates, there's not much risk, at least to moving the disease elsewhere, because those antlers generally don't get thrown out elsewhere after. So antlers can be removed from a surveillance area. One question here, can CWD be spread or be contaminated by a deer being shot in the spine or vertebrae? With CWD, pretty much anything is possible. So as far as an area being contaminated, yeah, I mean, at a kill site, the deer was positive. There could be a little bit of contamination there from blood after the deer died. But again, this is, you know, again, salivation, urination, all the natural processes the deer goes through can contaminate the area. So there's already prions in the area at that point. As far as contaminating the meat, yeah, if you take a spinal shot, you probably want to trim around that anyway, just because of bloodshot and lead fragments. And we do recommend minimizing any contact with the spinal cord during processing. It's just good practices during any kind of meat processing. So refrain from making chops and cutting through the spine. You'll have to cut through the spine to remove a head. It might be wise to use a different knife instead of processing the whole deer with that knife after severing the spinal cord. So it is best to try to remove that when possible. Another question, prions in soil or on cars or trucks spreading the disease? Again, anything is possible. However, the risk probably posed by dust or dirt getting on a vehicle and therefore being moved and potentially impacting another deer herd is much lower than what we talk about as high risk movement parts. That's again the spine, these parts that are very likely to be very high in CWD prion concentrations and therefore dumped later. Question about genetic testing for natural immunity. There's a lot of research going on in the genetic world. There's been a lot of deer tested, looking at different parts of the deer genome and how that relates to genetic susceptibility of the deer. There's never been a deer up until now that's been found to be truly resistant to CWD. There's some deer that naturally take a little bit longer to develop symptoms. So instead of 16 months, it might be a little over 2 years or three. But on average, most deers about 16, 24 months, and all of them eventually will develop the disease.
So we had a couple questions about testing roadkill. So we 100% plan to coordinate with DOT. We've already started that process, and we'll be testing roadkill, particularly from Cumberland County and from some of the surrounding counties once there is a increase in roadkill. Right now in the summertime, it's kind of hard to get out there and test that sample, especially when it's 90 degrees. That sample does degrade, which takes us into a few other questions. It says, can you test pre-frozen deer carcasses, and do heads need to be refrigerated if not turned in? So if you kill a deer and you put that head inside a garbage bag and put it in your freezer, it can last in there for easily the 2 weeks before you need to come and get it tested from us. If you've already frozen it beforehand, that's perfectly fine, because if it goes in a freezer, it's going to freeze there. If you kill it and you don't have a way to refrigerate it, I would encourage you to go ahead and drop it off at testing sooner rather than later, because as any tissue, that tissue degrades, and over time it will be harder for us to get a valid sample from that tissue.
I got a couple right here. One, if you harvest a deer that has CWD, does that count against your tags or big and large pork card? And the answer to that is yes, it does. We will not be issuing any more tags for you to kill extra deer with lead.
That's also one of the top five questions.
Second question I have, what should we do with existing mineral sites? We understand that when our executive director sent this order down and it become a rule and law, we sprung it on you kind of quickly. And if you do have existing mineral sites, we ask that you come in compliance with what we have talked about today and clean those sites up as best you can, because it is unlawful to have mineral sites out right now.
I got two that are fairly similar to each other. One is, can CWD be transferred if a butcher bulk processes deer? And the short answer to that is yes. If you're mixing a whole bunch of deer together and one of them is CWD positive, you're grinding into sausage. Well, yeah.
you end up with prions all over that. So that is a concern. We recommend that if this is something that's a great concern to you, that you ask that your heater be individually processed. It just sort of comes with the territory, unfortunately. Another question is, in what scenario ought a hunter wait to consume their deer harvest until the completion of a, well, basically, should you wait until you get a not detected CWD test? And do we recommend waiting for test results on every deer? And the answer to that from all of us up here would agree is yes to both. It would be our recommendation, if you're getting your deer tested, you might as well wait for that result to come in. I promise you will get a phone call from us if it is anything except not detected. If you have an email on file with the agency, you'll get an email from me, or specifically from me. But yeah, we would recommend that you have all your deer tested and that you wait until you get those results. Outside the mandatory period, again, that's voluntary. So it's only mandatory for those couple of weeks, but we recommend it for all of your deer.
One of the questions says, is there any info on how Gen X affects deer or hazards associated with consumption? We are, I guess, I live right above DuPont, and I'm very aware of Gen X. We don't currently have any active testing of Gen X in deer going on. We have partnered, our EC has partnered with NC State on testing, I believe, catfish and some alligators on Gen X testing. But we don't have any ongoing testing of Gen X and how that would impact you eating it or any other associated hazards with consuming Gen X.
Okay, so there's a question here. Why don't we go to a statewide secondary surveillance area? That really just comes down to efficiency. To have so the secondary surveillance area, really the main designation there, if we went statewide, would be that there would be 2 weeks of mandatory testing statewide. It takes a whole lot of staff time and resources to conduct mandatory testing. It's a really big time investment. In fact, we'll be pulling staff from the western part of the state, from the northeastern corner, to come and work those mandatory weeks here, so that basically, we see it as if we're asking hunters to comply with regulations, that they have to be tested during these weeks, that we need to be out there too. And that that you should be able to go somewhere and see someone in a green shirt and be able to talk to one of us. So there is a lot of staff burden with mandatory testing and with the secondary surveillance area. And we do test deer statewide. In fact, we tested 10,000 deer last year statewide outside of our surveillance areas in the Northwest. So we have increased surveillance. It's just not a proper secondary surveillance area. Other question, understanding what the prions can't be destroyed, is there anything that can be done to treat the soil in affected areas? And currently the answer to that, unfortunately, is no. The only way to make one of these COD prions uninfectious is really to basically cook it. We have mobile incinerators that we can use for doing that. We can incinerate infected deer carcasses. So if we have a positive, we'll try to incinerate all those parts so that those prions aren't infectious. But to do that, put a whole deer carcass in, you get a pile of dust on the other side. So there's really no way to effectively do that across the environment. Prescribed fire doesn't do anything to prions. There's no way to broad scale treat the environment.
All right, I'll jump in here and answer this because we've got a couple questions about this one. So we had a couple different questions that wanted to know why Moore County wasn't included in the surveillance area, because it technically touches right there in Cumberland, that part of Cumberland County. So, I mean, to be honest with you, we took lessons from last year. We made a logistical call here to see where exactly we might find it this year. Several different states do their surveillance areas different. Some of them, if a positive is found within 15 miles of the county's border, that county becomes part of a surveillance area. Last year, we followed our plan specifically, and we used a 5 mile radius and a 30 mile radius. And we had counties divided by roads and different kind of things. It got really confusing for sportsmen. Surprisingly, some people don't know where they hunt. And then it got confusing for enforcement officers, like, where did this come from?
it became very clear that home counties was the best way, the easiest way to understand how to do this. We looked at it, we talked about it, commissioners talked about it, we had discussions openly with commissioners. My recommendation was, you know, there's a very small part of Moore County that touches Cumberland. I mean, one could argue, if not, why not Moore County, why not Johnston County? It's not that far, it's within the dispersal range, but near the positive. So truthfully, guys, we tried to make it as easy to understand, as easy to enforce. Because remember what we're trying to do this first year. We're just trying to, it's a improved cylinder shotgun right now. We're just trying to get out there and see if we can find it, see where it's at. And, you know, my next year, you might very much see this change. We may see positives show up north, south, east. We don't know where they're going to show up. Keep in mind, they're still going to be testing deer in Moore County, okay? And there's probably going to be a lot of voluntary testing in Moore County. That's what happened up with the adjacent counties. We had a lot of testing in District 5, which was adjacent to District 7. So we feel like we're still going to be getting significant testing results out of there. So that's the short and long, rather long answer to why we decided to call that the surveillance area. We did a little bit of the same thing over in the western part of the state. We got a positive in Wilkes, but it was way over on this side of the county. So we're going to wait on these counties over here until we see where the disease is moving or where maybe it's already at. We haven't found it. So that's the answer to that question. And then I got one more. Or is that correlated to that? Oh, so this is a good question. I wish I knew the answer to this question definitively. But the question is, if no CWD is discovered in these counties, from whoever wrote this, mouth to God's ears, what is the timeline to revert back to previous baiting practices? I mean, the short answer to that is there really isn't one by the second. We've got to figure out what's going on. The only place, and correct me if I'm wrong, right, but the only place in the country that has actually happened was New York, where they found one or two positives. They're not exactly sure how they got there. They found them, and they've never found them since. Maybe that happens to us down here. But they never found any more. So you know, I don't know. If we do this for 5 years and we've not detected another single CWD deer in this neck of the woods, then we're probably gonna sit down at the table and say, okay, what do we do? Where are we at with CWD now? Was that a one-off, a weird thing that never showed up again? I don't have a lot of anticipation that that's going to be the case, y'all. Ironically, last year we had the one in Yakin. That was the first one to show up. Well, once we started doing the testing, the most positives we got was in Surrey County. So, you know, but the one in Yakin was right on the line. But, you know, so we'll see what this year looks like over there.
All right, we had a question about picking up a deer off the roadkill permit that was issued. And if the deer was tested and came back with a negative result. So I'm not 100% sure where we're getting that. Can you clarify your question a little bit?
Yeah, so when, as I understand it, to pick up a deer that you may have hit, you have to get a wildlife officer to come out and inspect and get issued a permit. When I had that happen in February, I was told that because of the recent CWD positive, that they weren't doing that. So I'm just wondering if that's going to be something that'll change or how that'll look if it's tested and it's negative a year that you were to hit.
As of right now, we'll still be issuing those permits until further notice. So nothing should change on that. And I have another question right here. What impact on landowners in the denoted counties who raise hogs on the ground in fenced areas? It won't affect you any at all. It'll be business as usual.
I would circle back on the roadkill stuff. I mean, the don't give it a ride thing still applies. If you pick up a roadkill deer in Cumberland County, don't take any part of it except for the legal parts out. And that's just, you know, that's got to be an honest, just you guys, you know, pay attention to that. But that's, you don't want to hit one, pick it up, and then take it over to, you know, two counties away or whatever.
so.
Right, we also urge them to test it.
Oh, yes.
Test it.
Yeah, especially if it's the time of year when the freezers are out and all that stuff, go ahead and get it tested. If it's not then, as John Henry said, look him up, give him a call if you're gonna take one, so he can get the, he can pull the samples for you.
Yeah, I had a question here about landfill options and whether or not we made contact with the various landfills in the surveillance area. And also a question about dumpster options, which John Henry hit on a little bit in his presentation, but we have contacted all the landfills in the six county surveillance area. The short answer is that most of them will accept deer carcasses, but you need to contact them ahead of time. You can call them ahead of time. Give them a heads up that you're coming. And right now, the dumpster options that we're providing, we'll have one at Suggs Mill Pond, and we'll have one at the Peckham Center. At this point in time, we're not planning on having additional dumpsters specifically for folks to bring deer carcasses.
Got a couple more here. First question, is there an oral vaccine? There is no vaccine or any kind of treatment currently for deer. There is work being done, a lot of research to try to develop something like that, but as of right now, there's nothing that could be administered to deer that could cure them of CWD. So no oral vaccine. Another question, is there any correlation between the reported reduction of deer, buzzard populations and CWD-infected deer consumed by buzzards that also might be transporting prions? So as far as any kind of vultures dying, Sarah can speak to this, that there's of course reports of that with avian influenza, and that's more of her world in the wildlife health realm. There has been research done with prions, CWD prions, and carrion eaters like crows and vultures, and as of right now, even in the lab, none of those birds actually contract CWD and develop symptoms. Doesn't seem to affect them. However, they can eat it and fly away and excrete it elsewhere, and those prions are infectious. So there could be excrement that's actually moved from a carrion pile elsewhere with birds flying. There's really no way to avoid that, but again, that I mentioned before with CWD, you start thinking about it too much, a lot of different things are possible. Maybe not necessarily probable. Last question I got here, what state are you modeling after and how effective was it? So the regulations that we're implementing here, you know, especially the carcass movement, fawn rehab ban, even touching on the use of different urine products, these are all regulations and actions that are set forth by there's actually a national association called the Association of Fish and Wildlife Agencies. Basically, their best heads on the CWD and disease management got together years ago and put together a guiding document with recommendations on how agencies should address CWD. All of the things that we're doing are in that document. And if you look at other states that anywhere in the eastern U.S., every state that has CWD has some form of the regulations that we've implemented. As mentioned earlier, some states are a lot more extreme, like Illinois and Minnesota. Some of those states are actually shooting deer. We're not doing that. But wherever you are, there's carcass movement restrictions because all states realize that's the best way to keep it from getting moved. There's some restrictions regarding bait and feeding. A lot of states have banned it altogether, but some have and some haven't. But again, what we're modeling after is what all state agencies are working toward, and that is hitting on the main points that we as the hunting community can to try to address the disease.
Another question, I think we hit on it during the presentation, but just to be clear on, is there hard data to show that deer feeders spread CWD? There's hard data that shows that the infectious prions are in saliva. Hard data that shows that those prions can persist in the environment for decades or more. Hard data to show that deer can come by and ingest those prions and become infected themselves. So essentially, yes.
I've got question, which I think we answered, but just for clarification, someone asked if their harvest is taken during the mandatory submission period, is that hunter compelled to forego mounting the deer as you must submit the head? And the answer to that is no. If you want to have your deer mounted, the Servant Health Cooperator tax agreements would be able to pull those samples for you. If it takes to one of us, we'll probably put a big old hole in the neck, but yes, you can take it to the Servant Health Cooperator tax agreements and have that deer mounted.
You can also take on to one of the Servant Health Cooperator taxidermists, and a lot of them will, you know, if you have a particular taxidermist that you'd like to use somewhere else, they'll generally take the deer for you and pull the samples and fix it such that you can take the legal part. Say you have your cousin in Iron County mounts your deer for you. The health cooperators can take your deer, process your buck, get it ready, and you can take it elsewhere if you want to. They use it. You need to pay them to do that, but that's usually one of the techniques to do that. Let me real quick, since you got the mic, I'm actually going to circle back because Jason Allen texted me a thing to remind everybody, and they said John Henry was talking about how long you've got and put it in the freezer. I think there was a question about that. And we probably should make clear, you've got 2 weeks to submit your sample, but don't leave it laying on the picnic table for 2 weeks or in the back of the truck. If you're going to wait, if it's going to be 4, 5, 6 days before you drop it in one of the freezers to get it somewhere, throw it in some ice, please. Otherwise, because it's pretty nasty, and also the test results can be impacted because it will start to deteriorate. But we did have a few last year who, you know, they said, hey, we got your deer heads over here, and you know, they've been laying there for a week, and it was not a good experience. I didn't have to do that, but just as a reminder for that, if you are one of the misconceptions we had last year is everybody thought it was like checking your deer in. You had to get that sample there the day you killed the deer. Well, no, we got a little time to get to check your deer in, but you're gonna want that authorization number. But you know, please throw it in the cooler if it's gonna be, you know, 3, 4, or 5 days before you take it to John Henry. Y'all got some more?
Yeah, I think we got one more. It asks for review of the rehab rules. The rehab rules are you can't move a fawn. Pretty much there is no rehab for fawns. So if something were to happen to that adult doe, Mother Nature is just going to take its course in that situation.
So.
A few times for some more. If anybody can write them on a piece of paper or anything, if anybody's got other questions. You got another one, Ron?
I do. So the question is, what to look for in a deer with CWD? And there's no way to look at a deer and know it has CWD. I mentioned earlier there's a long incubation period. During that 16 to 24 months, the deer would look normal. Even at the point where it's emaciated, super skinny, and you know, even saying they're drooling, you can't look at the deer and know it has CWD, and that's because there's actually a lot of different things that can cause the deer to look that way. Seen it with deer hit by cars, any kind of injury. It's also really common with bucks during the rut from sparring. They'll get a hole in their head, they'll develop an abscess, and eventually it'll erode down to their brain. They'll get brain abscesses, and it will cause a deer to wander in circles and drool and act oddly. The deer gets pneumonia or is compromised for another reason. They can eventually look really emaciated and just in really poor condition. So there's really no way in the field to look at a deer and know it has CWD. There might be clues if you're right there at the very end of its life and it's been infected for a long time. The only way to know definitively is to have the deer tested. Whether it looks healthy or not, there's no way to know.
Okay.
So we have a question asking, is there a known cooking or internal meat temperature that will kill CWD proteins as you cook with bacteria? It's going to be so burnt to a crisp, there's not meat left. I mean, we have to use, if you think about how hot an incinerator gets, we have to get an extra high temp incinerator to be able to destroy it. So there is no meat left by the time we've hopefully deactivated that seeding ability, that ability for prions to bounce into each other and create new misfolded prions. The temperature for that is super, super high. Your oven cannot compete.
Wow.
While we're waiting on that question, I am going to also comment. Somebody asked, and that's probably one of the top three questions. If I shoot a deer and it's positive for CWD, can I get my tag back or whatever? The answer for that is no, you have to check it in to do it. But we are working on options as we move through, and we're working on options as we get into management where that we may can make replacement tags available if you get your deer tested. But it's not there yet. Bear with us. We're working through the process. But if you have a situation, we do have some things for private landowners and things. We do have a program that can work in the primary area for sure. So I just, if you've got a situation, you might want extra tags, whatever. Talk to John Henry about that.
So I got a question here. Can we still bait for hogs? The answer to that is no. We cannot. Through August 31st to
September 1st to January 1st, right?
Yes. And that's unless it was an agriculture practice like we talked about earlier with raising hogs in the fenced area, we're not gonna take that.
So this is a good question. I don't know if I'm gonna let answer this one, but that's a problem. What is the chance at the drop-off station being full and you can't drop off your deer? Who wants to answer that?
I'll just say that's never going to happen, Brandon. No, in all seriousness, it was somewhat in our Northwestern surveillance area last year. It was somewhat a work in progress. And there were some days when they were pretty close to being very full, but we very quickly set up a schedule. A lot of the enforcement officers would swing by, you know, a couple times a week and clean them out. So it's pretty unlikely you're going to run into that. Now, I will say this. We had to chain the pins to the freezer because the pins would walk away. So you might want to bring a pin.
Bring your own pin, please, because there may not be one there. You fill out the little card. Right.
No, in all seriousness, I think a little bit of coordination here locally, that shouldn't be too big of an issue.
It is a monumental task, and it required up in the Northwest all of our law enforcement staff, most of our wildlife staff, constantly setting up a schedule to get to those freezers especially during the mandatory period, and everybody else is still doing the rest of their other jobs too, especially our law enforcement guys. So kudos to those folks up there, and I know they're going to knock it out down here the same. So. But we're doing everything. We've even ordered some bigger freezers and some things. We're learning as we go along.
You can put John Henry's phone number on every one of them.
Yeah, well, it will be. Yeah, he'll have his phone number. Now, we do have a contact number, so. Because we had to pop up a couple times where the freezer got full. And they were just like piling them up on the outside of the thing. We had to, luckily it was colder, so.
So we've got a couple more good questions here. One is, what is the likelihood of CWD infecting other game animals? Obviously, we have white-tailed deer here in North Carolina. Other members of the deer and elk family, so moose, elk, mule deer, those things, yes, it can infect those animals. Other species that we have here, gray squirrels, wild turkeys, cottontail rabbits, no chance of that happening, essentially. Yeah, so that's a good thing if that's not a risk. And then we have a question about slides and presentations. I'll look back at Fairley, our communications director, a little bit. So the presentation is being live streamed tonight. That's also available after the fact, I guess through YouTube primarily, or our agency's website.
Well, I think we cataloged on Carolina Sportsman, and we'll also have it then. But we're going to take a lot of the questions that we've heard here tonight. If it's not addressed on the website, then we'll make sure we have that information.
Yeah, so very good. So a lot of the information that's in the questions will be compiled. It'll be up there. You can watch the presentations again, and the slides are right there as well. Anybody else here to take a job on any questions? Yes, sir.
So what about the farmers with getting depredation permits and shooting year round? What are you going to do with that?
So if you're inside the surveillance area, for a farmer to get a depredation permit, it is mandatory that they submit a deer head to us for testing. So any farmers who are requesting permits this year, it is written on their permit that they have to submit heads. We're setting up freezers for those guys. We're trying to make it accommodate them as much as possible, but we are trying to get every possible sample that we can get, including those.
So leading up to the rule changes that you made with the 2-buck limit, I asked the question then, what's the trigger mechanism to change those? Because there was a 10-year study that went into that, and the answer was there is none. So it took 10 years of study in a general assembly vote to change it, right? So what's going to cause us to be able to change the butt to toe kill ratio a couple of years down the road when it needs to happen?
So, actually, the commission passed a rule to be the general assembly for to produce the statewide uniform 2-buck limit. That'll stay in effect the way it is. The way we'll adjust it, probably adjust the management in the CWD management zones will be to offer extra tags that will be able to address harvest in those specific areas. What will individual hunters do? Will they respond to that? You know, that's a personal choice, but ultimately that will be available.
But the idea behind the last rule change is to increase the age structure, and obviously increase the age structure isn't a...
And now we flip it upside down.
So,
and we're watching and learning and trying to decide. You know, one of the first things I challenged Mariah to do once we got a positive, I said, write me a memo, the deer team that we've got a group of deer volunteers. What's CWD deer management look like? You know, we know we have traditional deer management, maximum sustained yield, like we all used to grow up hunting, where, you know, you just went hunting and you killed as many deer as you could kill every year, and what the limit said, and we transitioned and we wanted to get older age structure, which a lot of people still want, and we still want to see that, but we do know that those older age structures and those older bucks are more likely to have chronic wasting disease, so.
But you're not going to want them to kill 4 does when the numbers start to drop.
Well, we'll have to moderate the doe harvest when we get, we're not going to see much of this, and quite frankly, in our lifetimes, we're not going to see a lot of that. It's going to be, like Mariah was saying, decades down the road. But we're going to have to keep a watchful eye on what deer densities are doing and how much doe harvest pressure you want, because you have to adjust for that lack of productivity that's inevitably going to be there. So, we're looking at all this stuff, trying to say we're the ones that are going to set it, and then the folks that are going to come after us, and all the hunters that are going to come after us in this room, we're going to, you know, figure out how we adjust and moderate. And other states are doing the same thing, but you know, really, in terms of CWD world, east of the Mississippi, we're just getting some of the states that have had it for 30 years. You know, Wisconsin and some of those. Tennessee probably has. Because they're finding it all over the western part of Tennessee now. They just missed it early on. But that's the challenges that are coming up in regulatory deer management. That's what we have to do. You know, how do we shift the buck carcass to you? And you're right, great observation. Everything we've worked on for over a decade in terms of our age structure.
It's working too.
It's working, absolutely it's working. And now some of that's, philosophy flips a little bit, but you know, how far you go in the other direction, you don't know quite. I mean, we're not suggesting we want to get rid of all mature bucks on the landscape, you know. But yeah, we're gonna change our ways a little bit over the course of the next foreseeable future. Right now, let's just get a bunch of samples. Hunt the way you hunt, get a bunch of samples, let's figure out where it's at, and then in 3 to 5 years or whatever, we'll figure out what the game plan is and where, you know, where we need to define our efforts to focus that, if that makes sense.
Has there been any, I know you flipped that on all the testing done, buck and buck, antler deer and all that, but of the 9 that have been identified so far, is there any correlation between more does, more bucks, or do you know what the numbers are?
Yes, they've all been bucks put to. And coincidentally, the only 2 does that tested positive actually weren't hunter harvested deer. However, it's just a coincidence. We test a lot of does. Test a lot of does and a lot of bucks, but so far it's been really heavy on the buck side, which isn't all too surprising, especially early on to protect the disease. The bucks are out there, the ones really starting to spread around, move around. Yes, so far that's been the case. That doesn't in any way undermine the importance for testing those, because we will for sure pick it up in those.
Is that something the other states seem to
Yes, in every state's kind of at different stages of disease in the area where they have it, and some the numbers are getting pretty close to even, and some, they're a really big difference. For instance, in Wisconsin, something like 55-60% of adult bucks have the disease, and maybe 30% of those. So there can be kind of a difference between the two there.
Let's go right here.
I want to just make sure I'm clear on planted food plots. You said that we still can do planted food plots.
Yes.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Here.
Is there any relationship between prion disease and deer and with cattle and sheep? Is there any transmission there?
So the question is the relationship between, well, what amounts to mad cow disease, scrapies, and chronic wasting disease, and is there any kind of risk? You want to handle it? You want me to handle it? I mean, so they're the same type of disease. They're transmissible, transform encephalitis. I have practiced a long time to be able to say that. There is one theory that chronic wasting disease came from experiment scrapie infected sheep at the University of Colorado. Colorado State. I don't want to blame you right now.
Colorado State.
No real proof that that accident is, it's a logical thing. As far as we know, there's no transmission between scrapies doesn't transmit. You know, that's one of the theory of how the mad cow disease transferred to humans was because they were feeding them rendered scrapie infected sheep. So this is a crazy disease in a crazy, crazy world. But as far as we know right now, there's no transmission of either disease between species. Correct statement? So the only relationship is that they're the same type of disease. Yes, sir?
Sorry, I missed part of the earlier response in regard to the question about getting a copy of the slides.
Well, will the slides be available on the website?
Yes, they will.
The slides will be available on the website.
We'll get them up tomorrow.
We've got to incorporate this into our Hunter Ed classes, and we don't have enough time to cover the material now, but the district four instructors, we got to figure out some way to get this stuff out to the students we're going to have this fall.
And we'll work with our education staff to make sure that they have the packages for that.
I do just want to add, that's kind of been a work in progress. You know, in the last year, the Hunter Education booklet was updated, and I put information in there, updated all of that. The issue and the challenge is there's kind of a time lag right between gathering information and getting it into the booklets and getting it out. And so sometimes the information that we're getting in from the field happens really quickly, and we're making regulation changes really quickly, so we can't necessarily put those regulations in the education booklet because they really belong in the regulations digest, but we're trying our best to update what is provided to instructors through the booklet so that hunters are being taught that, hey, this is something
we've got to cover things like collecting samples, depositing samples, during the 2-week window around Thanksgiving, because this ties right in with punching the card when you kill a deer. Basically the same requirements for that 2-week period.
And we'll work on continuing to improve that and get that information available to the hunter. Yes, sir.
The baiting year round, has that already been terminated?
Yes. Yes. The executive director did that with proclamation with executive order. And that's already been in case in surveillance area one, and it is now in effect in surveillance area two as well. And the temporary rules have just come out.
When did that become in effect?
Two months ago. I can't remember the exact date.
I think it was April 11th.
And we have temporary rules in place out there right now. In fact, the comment period just closed, and so the commission will be moving towards enacting the temporary rules, and then eventually those will become permanent rules and surveillance rules.
Any pressure going to be put on merchants?
Merchants for
all this stuff you say we can't use certain times of year and being sold heavily all those times too.
I mean,
unfortunately,
obviously, the guy that wants to do the right thing, the reason breaks, he'll know, because everybody does do the right thing, and everybody don't know.
Right. I mean, for some of these, like the deer urine, the good thing is that most of the major urine manufacturers are in compliance with the routines. Most of them are in compliance with that. As far as, you know, what somebody sets myself home, I mean, it's a home. The illegal thing is not placed on landscape, quite frankly. So that's the illegal thing. Y'all can put pressure on. Is your deer hurt? Yes, ma'am.
Are there any other opportunities that we sportsmen can do to besides spreading the word and encouraging others to follow the compliance? What can we do to help you?
I think right now, if I had one ask of every hunter in the state of North Carolina and every sportsman, every conservationist, is to do that. It's to make sure people understand this is real, but that we're taking a logical approach, that we're trying to, you know, move in a positive direction, encourage people that getting their deer tested during a mandatory testing period is very important. What you do with your deer after you get it tested, that's fine. Just get the deer tested. You know, if it's positive, you'll get a phone call, but we're not going to tell you what to do with your deer. You can eat it, you can do whatever you want to. I think encouraging testing, really, really recognizing the seriousness of moving carcass parts outside of these areas. You know, as Mariah pointed out, you know, we know prions can be moved in carcass parts. We know that can happen. We know it's convenient to throw the deer in the back of the truck and take off home. If home happens to be outside of one of these counties, skin the deer, do whatever you do, know where to go before you throw it or whatever. But you don't want to be that person that moved CWD to some other county. We don't know how it got here, but you know, we don't want to be the person that, oh Lord, they found it in Newman County and I took my deer home and moved it. They found it right behind my house. We're probably not going to be able to tell that, but the point of the matter is, I mean, anything else you guys would add to that? I think the carcass, the importance of not taking carcass parts, those potentially infected parts, out of this zone, especially until we figure out what we got and what, you know, what it is, and then getting those deer tested and just sort of maintaining that this is a real thing. Sky's not falling. It's not the end of the world. We're still going to deer hunt. We're going to deer hunt just like mostly like we've been deer hunting for right now. We're going to adjust things as we go along, as we learn more. But it is real, and we need to take actions and be responsible for what we do when we're out there in the woods.
I would just add to that the fact that there's this many people here is encouraging.
Yes.
That y'all are paying attention to CWD. That's been a hard thing for us to get across to hunters. And we've been trying for years to get people to pay attention to CWD. And so when you hear CWD, just perk your ears up and listen. Main things.
Well, thank you for that question. So we got about 10 minutes scheduled time. I think that's correct. We'll sit around here and chat. I think we'll let Facebook Live go down. If it's not already going down, I'm not sure if they're still out there. If they're still out there, thank y'all for joining us tonight too. Otherwise, we'll hang out for a little bit. Conversations around the corner. Anybody in the green shirt? Thank you, everybody. Like John said, thank you all for being here. We appreciate it. We'll see you in there soon.